Welcome to another episode of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacier ice boulders that were ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. Today, we will examine Antioch Bay in North Carolina, which is a dedicated nature preserve under the ownership of the Nature Conservancy. This LiDAR image shows a well-defined elliptical geometry of Antioch Bay with an orientation similar to the other bays in the area. The bay has a multiple rim at the southeastern end, which was caused by the plowing action of overlapping projectiles as they penetrated the surface while the terrain was still in a state of liquefaction. The Savannah River Ecology Laboratory from the University of Georgia has a Carolina Bay fact sheet that defines the Carolina Bays as isolated wetlands in natural shallow depressions that are largely fed by rain and shallow groundwater. These bays have an elliptical shape and generally a northwest to southeast orientation. They are found primarily in Georgia and the Carolinas, but range from Florida to Delaware. As many as 300 Carolina Bays exist in the Savannah River site. Carolina Bays vary in size from less than an acre to many acres. Water levels are normally lowest in autumn and highest in early spring. Some Carolina Bays, like Jones Lake State Park in North Carolina, have water all year, while others fill with water and then dry up, depending on the season. The amount of time a typical bay holds water can vary greatly from year to year, depending upon rainfall. For example, during a 13-year period, Rainbow Bay on the Savannah River site held water only 5 days one year and about 280 days another year. YouTube user Paleo Travels posted a video of the interior of Antioch Bay, which he recorded during a trip for a biology course called Regional Natural History. A link to the video is provided in the description below. The predominant vegetation on this bay consists of a cypress savanna with a diverse ground cover and an open canopy. Average water depth and soil type have a large influence on the types of plants found in and around Carolina Bays. Many bays contain trees such as black gum, sweet gum, magnolia, bald cypress, and maple, and shrubs such as sumac, buttonbrush, and red bay. Antioch Bay is populated predominantly by a variety of grasses and bald cypress, Taxodium disticum, which is a deciduous conifer that develops a wide-spreading base that narrows up the trunk. Antioch Bay is located about 3 miles north of Red Springs, North Carolina. This LiDAR image shows a multitude of Carolina Bays, many of which overlap. A satellite image of the same area shows a landscape covered with farm fields in which it is difficult to identify the Carolina Bays. The glacier ice impact hypothesis, published in 2017, proposes that one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet by the Great Lakes ejected pieces of ice in ballistic trajectories. The secondary impacts of glacier ice produced seismic vibrations that liquefied unconsolidated soil, and the oblique impacts created inclined conical cavities that became shallow elliptical basins by viscous relaxation. In Nebraska, these basins are called rainwater basins, and along the Atlantic coastal plain, they are called Carolina Bays. Using ballistic equations, we can calculate that the glacier ice boulders ejected by the extraterrestrial impacts on the Michigan Peninsula had times of flight of 6 to 9 minutes, depending on the distance and launch angles. All the Carolina Bays formed within this 4-minute interval of saturation bombardment by the ballistic sedimentation of the ejecta curtain. Megafauna and Clovis people within 1,500 kilometers of the Michigan Peninsula were killed by the glacier ice impacts. There were survivors beyond this range, but they faced the hardships of the Younger Dryas cooling event that was triggered by the cataclysm. Looking at this LiDAR image, we see many bays that overlap. We can determine their sequence of formation using the geological law of superposition, which states that in a sedimentary sequence, the youngest layer is at the top and deeper layers are progressively older. We will focus our attention on a group of bays to the southeast of Antioch Bay. The overlaps of these Carolina Bays show impacts on at least 3 different levels. We can identify the older impacts because they are always overlaid by younger impacts. 3 old impacts are highlighted in this image. The bay marked as number 4 was emplaced next. We know this because it overlays bay number 2. Bay number 5 was emplaced after 1, 3, and 4 because bay 5 overlays portions of bay 1 and 3 and also the rim of bay 4. Antioch Bay displays all the characteristics of well-preserved Carolina Bays. It has elliptical geometry typical of oblique impacts and raised rims that are characteristic of impact cratering. It is on unconsolidated ground that could be liquefied by the ice boulder impacts, and it is oriented toward the Great Lakes. The bay is within 1,500 kilometers from the Great Lakes, which was the approximate range of the ice boulder impacts. Experimental oblique impacts of ice projectiles on a viscous target produce inclined conical cavities that are elliptical when viewed from above. Adjacent experimental impacts confirm the law of superposition and illustrate the transition of adjacent conical cavities into overlapping elliptical structures with raised rims after viscous relaxation. Multiple rims may be produced when one impact almost overlaps another one. The mathematically elliptical geometry of Antioch Bay can be confirmed by plotting some points along the perimeter of the bay and fitting them with an ellipse using the least squares method. Ellipses are conic sections. This implies that the bay originated as an inclined conical cavity, also called the penetration funnel. Antioch Bay is located 1,175 kilometers from Lake Michigan, which is assumed to be the point from which the ice boulder that made this basin was launched. The basin has a width of 593 meters and a length of 917 meters. The width-to-length ratio corresponds to an impact angle of 40.4 degrees. The diameter of the glacier ice projectile that made the basin is estimated to be 183 meters, which is one-fifth of the basin length and approximately the size of Yankee Stadium. That is a big chunk of ice. The ballistic equations indicate that the glacier ice boulder that made Antioch Bay was launched at a speed of 3.417 kilometers per second. It had a flight time of 7.53 minutes and reached a height of 250 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The trajectory was a suborbital space flight in the vacuum of space. The atmosphere extends only to 100 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The kinetic energy of the impact that made Antioch Bay was equivalent to 4.1 megatons of TNT, which would have caused seismic vibrations of magnitude 7.89. Those seismic vibrations were sufficient to liquefy the unconsolidated ground and to speed up viscous relaxation in any adjacent impact basins. The major axis of Antioch Bay has a heading of 131.4 degrees. Extending the major axis toward the Great Lakes forms a line that passes west of Lake Michigan. The major axis of the impact basins seem to converge at multiple points. This is an indication that several pieces of a disintegrating comet could have impacted the Laurentide ice sheet. Saginaw Bay was proposed as the site of an extraterrestrial impact by Michael Davias in 2010, and many lines converge there, but the major convergence point of the bays that I have studied is slightly west of Lake Michigan, which agrees with what Richard Firestone reported in his 2006 book titled The Cycle of Cosmic Catastrophes. If Lake Michigan was the site of an extraterrestrial impact when it was covered by the Laurentide ice sheet, the intersection of the lines is expected to be slightly west of the lake due to the Coriolis effect caused by the rotation of the Earth. Every time that we study the Carolina Bays, we learn a little bit more about the history of the Earth. Look at these perfect ellipses. They are mathematical conic sections. The geometry of these structures is derived from the physical forces that produce them. Everything that I have said in this presentation goes against mainstream geology. According to Wikipedia, most geologists today interpret the Carolina Bays as geomorphological features that develop via various aeolian and lacustrine processes, which is how geologists describe wind and water mechanisms. The fact that we can fit ellipses to the Carolina Bays by the least squares method is not explained by the wind and water hypothesis. Much of the support for the aeolian and lacustrine hypothesis is based on theories from the 1940s before the invention of LIDAR and on an experiment by Raymond Kaczorowski, which was described in a 1977 report that was never published in a peer-reviewed journal. The experiment failed to produce an elliptical structure. A subsequent attempt in 2012 to replicate Kaczorowski's experiment also failed. As far as I know, no aeolian lacustrine experiment has ever been attempted to produce overlapping bays. I have placed a link to the video debunking Kaczorowski 1977 in the description of the video below. When a hypothesis fails, it is time to move on and try something else. That is the only way in which science can advance. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.